So, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I would like to thank the organizing committee and especially Peter Kotenga for the kind invitation to give a lecture at this year's virtual conference. The topic that I'm asked to discuss with you is COVID-19 and end-stage renal disease and acute kidney injury. These are my disclosures. I have nothing to disclose. In this presentation, after a short introduction, I will talk shortly about the pathophysiology and staging of COVID-19. After that, I will focus on COVID-19 caused in dialysis patients and the role of COVID-19 in acute kidney injury. The question is, why do dialysis patients have an increased risk for COVID-19? Of course, the treatment options of COVID-19 in patients with end-stage renal disease and some specific considerations for azacopria treatment and acute kidney injury will be discussed. And at the end, I will come with a short summary and conclusion. You all know that emerging and re-emerging pathogens are global challenges for public health. And you all remember the H1N1 and the Ebola virus infection in the last 10 to 15 years. And but the problems are with that, with our healthcare. However, 1 year ago, in December 2019, a cluster of patients with pneumonia of unknown cause was linked to a seafood wholesale market in Wuhan, China. And a previously unknown beta coronavirus was discovered. Human airway epithelial cells were used to isolate the novel coronavirus named 2019-nCoV, and which formed a clade within the subgenus Sarbeco viruses. The 2019-nCoV is the seventh member of the family of coronaviruses that infect humans. And the detection of SARS-related coughs in bats and small animals in retained markers may indicate an interspecies transmission from bats to small animals and finally to humans. And several studies indicate that SARS-CoV has been circulating in bats for a long time before genetically changing and jumping finally to humans. On the basis of knowledge of other coronaviruses, the main route of human-to-human transmission of the 2019-nCoV is probably through respiratory droplets. Statistical data show that the outbreak constitutes a pandemic threat, but the exponential increase in patients has reached globally more than 17 million confirmed cases and more than 1.6 million deaths. In this figure, the complex pathophysiology of COVID-19 is shown. And SARS-CoV enters the host cell through interaction with a spike protein with the entry receptor, the ACE2, in the presence of TMPRSS2. The proposed mechanisms for COVID-19 caused by infection with SARS include a direct virus-mediated cell damage via this ACE2 receptor. Furthermore, there's a dysregulation of the RAS system as a consequence of downregulation of ACE2. Related, which leads to a decreased cleavage of angiotensin 1 and angiotensin 2, finally injury leading to tissue injury, inflammation, vasoconstriction, and finally vascular permeability. There's also a direct endothelial cell damage of the SARS-CoV infection, leading to a decline in fibrinolysis and increase in thrombin production. Fourthly, there's a dysregulation of the immune response and hyperinflammation caused by inhibition of the interferon signaling by the virus itself, a T-cell lymphodepletion, and the production of pro-inflammatory cytokines, particularly IL-6 and TNF-alpha, leading to a cytokine release syndrome. And this could clearly affect different organs, among lungs, heart, but also the kidneys. Siddiqui and Mera proposed the use of a three-stage classification system, recognizing that COVID-19 illness exhibits in three grades of increasing severity, which correspond to distinct clinical findings, response to therapy, and clinical outcome. And the initial stage occurs at the time of inoculation and early establishment of the disease. And this involves an incubation period associated with mild and often non-specific symptoms, such as malaise, fever, and a dry cough. And during this period, the SARS-CoV multiplies and establishes residence in the host, primarily focusing on the respiratory system. In patients who can keep the virus limited to this stage of COVID-19, the prognosis and recovery are excellent. In the second stage of established pulmonary disease, viral multiplication and localized inflammation in the lung are the norm. And during this stage, patients develop a final pneumonia, with cough, fever, and possibly hypoxia. Because in this stage, most patients with COVID-19 would need to be hospitalized for close observation and management. Stage 2 disease should be subdivided in stage 2A without hypoxia and stage 2B with hypoxia. And if hypoxia is used, it's likely the patient will progress to require mechanical ventilation. Luckily, a minority of our COVID patients will transit into the third and most severe stage of the illness, which manifests as an extrapulmonary systemic hyperinflammation syndrome. And in this stage, shock, tachyplegia, respiratory and cardiac failure are discernible. And systemic organ involvement would manifest during this stage. In this table, an overview of COVID-19 in the dialysis patient is shown. The incidence in all these studies varies from 0.03% to almost 20%. A substantial number of patients were asymptomatic at the time of diagnosis. But of the symptomatic patients, a significant number was admitted and also to the ICU ward. And finally, mortality was up to 30% in most of the studies and even to 50% in one study. So the incidence of COVID-19 is higher in the dialysis units. The case mortality rate in symptomatic patients is very high. And the dialysis patients are a risk group, both in terms of infection risk and outcome. The clinical presentation in patients may be obscured because chronic dyspnea is common because of fluid overload in our patients. And we also know that in arrhythmia, the febrile response may be blunted. And finally, a significant proportion of our patients was asymptomatic at the time of diagnosis screening. So hemodialysis patients are known to have an impaired humoral immune response to both vaccination and infection, and it is uncertain whether hemodialysis patients mount an effective antibody response against SARS-CoV-2. Despite the fact that in this study, all patients were found to produce specific antibodies against after COVID-19 infection, the response of the innate and the adaptive immune response to systemic SARS-CoV may be impaired due to a larger degree in the dialysis patients as compared to the general population. So immune deficiency is one of the numerous consequences of chronic kidney failure. And natural killer cells, which form the first line of defense against SARS-CoV, were found to be lower in the dialysis patients as compared to controls in earlier studies. And the same holds true for the naive CD4 and CD8 positive T lymphocytes, which are also involved in adaptive immunity against SARS-CoV. So the remodeling of the immune system that happens with aging in uremia may lead to modification in both the adaptive and the innate immunity. And the final results of these changes may trigger a maladaptive immune response against SARS-CoV-2. But it may be hypothesized that inadequate initial viral clearance due to immunosenescence results in a subsequent hyperactivation of an already stimulated innate immune system. So therefore, the dialysis patients are at risk group to a more aggressive disease that includes a cytokine release syndrome, disruption of the intrinsic lung defense and secondary bacterial pneumonia, endothelial injury, and finally, end organ damage. So to summarize this first part, dialysis patients may be more susceptible for COVID-19 due to an increased transmission risk at a dialysis ward. There's a chronic activation but reduced functioning of their immune system at the background of endothelial dysfunction. Damage to organs at the background of multi-organ pathology with reduced structural functional reserve may form increased risk for the systemic breakdown in our patients. In a systemic review, including more than 500 articles on COVID-19, 20 studies reported AKI, acute kidney injury data, according to the KDIGO data criteria. And the prevalence of acute kidney injury was in this study, in this review, more than 17%. And approximately 5% of all patients required the use of renal replacement therapy. AKI was in this review associated with an increased odds of death among COVID-19 patients with a pooled odds ratio of more than 15. However, There was a considerable heterogeneity across the studies and among different regions in the world. In this study, data of almost 5,500 admitted patients were reviewed. And of the patients admitted with COVID-19, ACHI developed in almost 37% of the patients. ACHI was primarily seen in COVID patients with respiratory failure, with 90% of patients on mechanical ventilation developing acute kidney injury, compared to only 22% of the non-ventilated patients. And of the patients who required ventilation and developed acute kidney injury, 22% had the onset of ACHI within 24 hours of intubation. But the risk factors for ACHI included older age, black race, hypertension, cardiovascular disease, and the use of vasopressin medication. But importantly, there was a high need for ventilation with an odd ratio of more than 10. In another retrospective study by Sean, in almost 4,000 hospitalized patients with COVID-19, ACHI occurred in 46% of the dialysis patients. While 90% of overall patients required dialysis, 32% of patients admitted to the ICU required dialysis. And approximately one-third of the patients did not have full renal recovery at discharge. And even 8% of the patients were still in stage 3 when they were discharged from the hospital. And furthermore, the hospital mortality in patients with ACHI was more than 50% and only 8% in the patients without ACHI. So although the pathophysiological understanding of COVID-19-related ACHI is yet not clear, current knowledge suggests some unspecific mechanisms, such as hemodynamic instability, fluid restriction, the use of nephrotoxic drugs, the high level of PEEP, and lung and heart dysfunction. But SARS has also a direct effect on the kidney, causing acute proximal tubular injury and podocyte dysfunction, leading to acute tubular necrosis. And I told you before, there's also imbalanced RAS activation, leading to glomerular dysfunction, inflammation, fibrosis, and vasoconstriction. But SARS-CoV-2 also triggers coagulation activation, leading to fibrinogen necrosis and glomerular ischemia. And finally, elevation of cytokines induced by severe SARS-CoV infection may also participate into the genesis of acute kidney injury. So when treating end-stage renal disease patients with COVID-19 on dialysis, it's of utmost importance to give the optimal dialysis treatment to prevent cardiovascular complications, such as fluid overload and hyperkalemia. Furthermore, is treatment of severe COVID-19 largely so supportive with supplemental oxygen therapy and prophylactic low molecular heparin in order to prevent the formation of thrombi. A large number of studies on more specific candidate treatments have been initiated. These can generally be divided in antiviral and immunomodulatory treatments. So based on the previous mentioned clinical stages, potential therapies can be implemented, as can be seen on the lower part of this slide. And whereas the progress in this field is very fast, trials with hydroxychloroquine and lopinavir and ritonavir have yielded largely negative results. We all know that steroids have proved efficacy in other studies on severely affected patients on the ICU. And in this study, dexamethasone 6 mg daily reduced the 28-day mortality in the patients with COVID as compared to usual care. In the dexamethasone group, the incidence of death was lower among patients receiving mechanical ventilation and also lower in those receiving oxygen without invasive mechanical ventilation. So adding hydroxychloroquine or lopinavir/ritonavir to the treatment did not result in less renal replacement therapies as compared to usual care. However, when adding dexamethasone, the treatment significant lower number of patients needed renal replacement therapy as compared to usual care. The drug remdesivir is an inhibitor of the viral RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. And the data from this study show that remdesivir was superior in shortening the time to recovery in adults hospitalized with COVID-19. However, data on the use of remdesivir in kidney failure are scarce and is generally contraindicated in patients because of impaired kidney function. However, It has been suggested that after adequate information and consent of the patient, Remdesivir could be used, but the benefits are believed to outweigh the risk. In the safety study, in patients with ARCHING and CKD, Remdesivir was well tolerated, including those on hemodialysis. But the author suggested larger, well-controlled studies are needed to evaluate the safety and efficacy in patients with kidney disease. However, the World Health Organization recommends against the use of Remdesivir in COVID-19 patients because there is no evidence that Remdesivir improves survival and outcome. In this detailed COVID-19 rapid guideline, it's clearly written how to deal with suspected or confirmed COVID-19 and how to assess for acute kidney injury. Using indicators of acute kidney injury, such as an increase in serum creatinine or decline in urine output, taking into account factors that further increase the risk of ARCHI, such as chronic kidney disease, heart failure, diabetes, and a history of acute kidney injury. Furthermore, information on how to manage fluid status and how to monitor this fluid status are given. This all in order to prevent the development of ARCHI in infection with COVID-19 patients. So what about the extracorporeal treatment of ARCHI in COVID-19? In patients with ARCHI, the indications to start renal replacement therapy are not different from the standard indications. However, apart from some logistic demands and the need for adequate protection of the team, there are some specific technical considerations, such as using higher standard QB for patients with COVID-19, the use of regional saturated anticoagulation, or the combination with saturated anticoagulation and additional systemic anticoagulation. Preferentially, three modalities that reduce the number of healthcare workers exposed to patients with COVID-19 are used. And when there's a shortage of devices, PD could be a reasonable alternative for these treatments. However, there are some clinical dilemmas. And I told you previously, there's an increased thrombogenicity and heparin resistance associated with COVID-19. This can also have important implications for circuit patency. And in this study, circuit clotting was reported in 28 of 29 patients on renal replacement therapy. And when comparing mismatched non-COVID patients on the ICU, the number of filters needed per day was significantly higher in COVID-19 patients as compared to non-COVID patients. So whereas many critically ill patients with COVID-19 may need systemic anticoagulation for thromboembolic complications, saturated anticoagulation with continuous venous hemodiafiltration could provide in general an excellent filter patency. Also, in this study, combining regional saturated anticoagulation with either continuous heparin intravenously or therapeutic dose nadoparin resulted in a significantly higher increase of filter time of 165% as compared with regional saturated anticoagulation alone. When looking over time, we can see there's increased survival in patients who received the renal replacement therapy. And this could be due to the timely implementation of the therapy, the using of renal saturated anticoagulation with oxygen, but also to use continuous heparin. This in combination with the dexamethasone 6 mg per day. But despite all the knowledge, interventions, the long-term outcome of ARCHI is poor, varying from 35% in the study mentioned earlier by John to almost 50% in the study by Bao. So to summarize, COVID-19 has greatly affected our dialysis patients. And COVID-19 presents in many of our patients with mild and unspecific symptoms, whereas the mortality rate is high. And artificial intelligence will be of great help to diagnose subtle changes in clinical and laboratory parameters that may point to the development of COVID-19, as can be seen in this slide, showing a nice area under the curve. In patients with developmental failure or aldialysis patients, they should not be refused for life-saving interventions and ICU admission. For patients with ARCHI, we all know that the mortality rate in patients RRT is very high, and there's an urgent need for improved treatment in these patients. Hemoabsorption might be of relevance in patients presenting with a cytokine storm, although more evidence is needed. So, in conclusion, in the face of the ongoing pandemic, it's expected that the nephrology community will continue to play a major role in the fight and treatment against this disease. And rapid sharing of experience and novel insights within our community will continue to be of great value for the treatment of all our patients. Since nowadays vaccination in the general population has started, we should start to vaccinate against COVID-19 as soon as possible in our vulnerable patients. With that, I want to thank you for your attention.